Good evening. Welcome to The Inclusion Show with Wallace Ford. I'll be your host this evening. And remember, The Inclusion Show is the only show that includes you. And now it's time to get busy. We're going to start off with an excerpt from my Point of View commentary blog, which appears online twice a week. Today's topic, the difference between white robes and black robes. Now, sometimes irony just isn't very funny. Take, for example, the instance of the Supreme Court of the United States, which is currently considering a case which would call for the overturning of the Voting Rights Act of 1964. And wouldn't you know it, this case is being brought by the Attorney General for the state of Alabama. If that's not enough irony, you should also know that a Supreme Court Justice, Antonin Scalia, the son of a Sicilian immigrant, thinks that's just fine. Well, maybe it's time for a little tutorial. The Voting Rights Act of 1964 was passed to provide a legal framework for black people to exercise their right to vote, because, and particularly to protect black people in the South who were being massacred and lynched and firebombed and killed at every instance where they tried to exercise that right to vote. The fact that much of this violence was directed at black men and women and their white supporters through mechanisms that involve the state and local governments in the South made it absolutely necessary that the federal government had to get involved. The law itself states that designated states cannot make any fundamental changes in the voting rights process without approval of the United States Department of Justice. Not surprisingly, the 9 states that are currently on the federal government's watch list are all in the South, all with a deep, grisly, gory, bloody history of violence against black Americans, especially when it involves black Americans trying to exercise their right to vote. Now, we now fast forward to 2013, and the Attorney General of the state of Alabama comes before the United States Supreme Court and says there's no more need for a Voting Rights Act because, like the rest of the United States, Alabama is in a post-racial era and there need be no further worry about discrimination against black Americans or any minorities for that matter. Now, incredibly, tomorrow morning, if you would go to Google or some other facility and look on the state of Alabama and its capital in Montgomery, you will see the state flag of Alabama flying over the Capitol building, as it does in all the other 49 states. The thing is, the state flag of Alabama is a St. Andrew's cross, which is intentionally modeled after the Confederate flag. Now, to provide some perspective, let's look at it this way. So imagine if you had some provincial governor in Germany proclaiming that they're no longer involved in anti-Semitic activity or behavior, while at the same time they were flying a flag that was modeled after the Nazi swastika. Now you start to get the point. Then you can understand therefore why the United States Department of Justice and black people in Alabama are more than a little skeptical and have very little confidence in this proclamation of a post-racial era in Alabama. For goodness sake, they're flying the Confederate flag as we speak. Now comes the Supreme Court Justice, Antonin Scalia, he of the Alito Scalia Thomas Roberts right-wing cabal. And although he had a singularly undistinguished career as a lawyer, he did manage to stumble onto the pages of history as being part of the hijacking and theft of an American presidential election in the year 2000. Not satisfied with that unfortunate distinction, however, Antonin Scalia is now taking the lead in trying to roll back the accomplishments of the civil rights movement, particularly with respect to legal and legislative accomplishments. And during the oral arguments involving the Voting Rights Act, he had the temerity and reptilian insensitivity to refer to the Voting Rights Act of 1964 as just another example of racial entitlement. Where does one begin with this racism soaked in stupidity and ignorance? Keep in mind the fact that when the Voting Rights Act of 1964 was passed, Antonin Scalia was 28 years old. He was a graduate of Georgetown University and the Harvard Law School and was a practicing attorney. He had to know that at that time, Birmingham, Alabama was known as Bombingham, because of the relentless attacks by white citizens against black citizens who were endeavoring to exercise their right to vote. Now, Antonin Scalia may feign ignorance, but he just had to know about the four little black girls who were killed in the Birmingham, Alabama church in a bomb attack, and the church was attacked because black Americans were using that church as a base to exercise the right to vote. He had to know about Schwerner, Cheney, and Goodman. He had to know about Medgar Evers and Viola Liuzzo and the Ku Klux Klan and George Wallace standing in the doorway of the University of Alabama to keep black men and women from trying to attend school. To term the Voting Rights Act or any civil rights legislation as racial entitlement is either ignorant or racist. One would have to be ignorant because to take this position, because that would be unaware of the institutional racism that has been directed against black Americans since the ratification of the Constitution of the United States that sanctioned slavery in 1789. Or one could be a racist for thinking that dismantling a legal and legislative infrastructure that imperfectly protects black Americans and others, other minorities, would be a good thing. Now, Antonin Scalia is the son of an Italian immigrant family, and he never faced obstacles to the exercise of his civil rights. And his father could get off a boat from Sicily and immediately walk a paved path to citizenship. How dare does Antonin Scalia and the Alito Roberts Thomas Scalia cabal try to deny that right to black Americans or anyone else. There may be a time when specific civil rights legislation to protect the rights of blacks and other minorities and women may not be necessary. But this is not that day, and Antonin Scalia should know that. And now it's time for From the Heart. The only words that come to mind when we look at what's going on with this sequestration disaster that is taking place in Washington, D.C. is Demolition Derby. But the thing is that Demolition Derby, of course, is derbies are for entertainment purposes, and this is not very entertaining at all. Watching a Teapublican-inspired dismantling of the federal government, brick by brick, building by building, institution by institution, is something that all of us should see as being a real big problem. Now, there's going to be a lot of people who are saying, well, it's not so bad. It's not that much pain going forward. But what we're talking about is the story of how you boil a frog. You don't put a frog in a pot of hot water. You put a frog in a pot of cold water and slowly turn the heat up bit by bit until the frog is a cold-blooded animal, of course, never realizes that it's being cooked until it's much too late. Similarly, this whole country is acting like one big damn frog, in that we are being boiled slowly. We are seeing this country's institutions being dismantled. We're seeing just the entire sense of governmental propriety being taken away bit by bit, as I said, brick by brick, stick by stick, until ultimately you'll start to see very real collapse. This is not doomsaying. This is just basic reality that we're looking at this point. And don't think for a moment that this is not intentional. Now, we've said before in other instances that this whole sequestration process was put in place because the thought was that no Republican, no Democrat, no Tea Party member, no lunatic, no idiot would ever want to see this country go through the effects and the impact of sequestration. Yet here we are with the sequestration process going forward, and now we're hearing people say it's not so bad. That's wrong. It is bad, and it is going to get worse. And it is hopefully about time for people, you and me, and anyone else who cares about what goes on in this country and what kind of world we're going to have, what kind of country we're going to have for our children, to take a stance and to take a role. There's no more time for playing around. Now, that concludes our show for this evening. We want to thank you again for watching The Inclusion Show. And remember, The Inclusion Show is the only show that includes you. Thanks a lot and good night.